There was an evening about twilight that I sat in my bedroom with a gun a few feet away. And I'd received some very disappointing news, and I felt utterly discouraged, and I felt like my life was never going to pan out. I was never really going to have any success at what I wanted to have. And as I sat there on that bed, I became obsessed just with one thought, that it would be so much easier if I could just pick up that gun. And as I sat there, just transfixed by that thought, this cave opened up in front of me. Image of a cave. And I couldn't see in it very well. There was a vague light at the dark, at the far end of it. And it beckoned me in. And I felt such a temptation to go in. And I knew at the end of that was like the end of all pain, the end of all discouragement, disappointment. And I sat there for quite a long time looking into it. My father had gone into that cave and had never come out. Sometimes things just spin out of control. More and more often, I found myself getting angry when things broke or someone crossed my path too quickly on the freeway. At other times, following setbacks, I became depressed and disconnected. As I looked around at my city, I saw an ugliness spreading. There was beauty, but I couldn't feel it. And beauty has to be felt, or it's like food without taste, a dullness on the tongue. When had I become so disconnected from the beauty of this world?
Just being near her. She was saying that, like, when you feel numb, you're not connected with God. Basically, that's how I was, like, totally numb. Like, I couldn't feel my feelings. So today I just made that my intention.
Some of my other friends had asked me and encouraged me and told me to come to one of these ceremonies.
Word was spreading about something called the ceremonies. Some maverick Seminole medicine man had started a Native American church called Oklevueha, and he was opening its doors to non-natives. White people doing native ceremonies. A few Indians were angry about it, but what was most striking was one of the medicines Oklevueha was offering. It was peyote. Normally, I would never have gone to something like this, but my son had dropped into a deep depression, and Western medicine was unable to help him out of it. Someone suggested a ceremony. I had traveled down some unusual paths in my life, but this one sounded like nothing more than another flaky New Age craze. That it might help my son made no sense. However, if someone had assured me that handstands on the interstate held the solution, I would have done them. I resolved to try one ceremony with my son. It was the craziest thing I'd ever done, And who were the people I met there? Were they yuppies getting stoned?
I was sent to prison in 1982 for criminal homicide.
Within a few years after entering the Marine Corps, I found myself in Vietnam.
I was at the end of a 10-year heroin addiction.
I set out with a lot of anger and hatred, and I set a few buildings on fire.
The relationship we're in, I am only enabling him to do self-destructive things, which in turn is very self-destructive to me.
The fact that I was a Vietnam veteran and that I was in combat for 11 months out of the 13 that I was there, and it was horrible. It wasn't fun combat or cool combat or movie combat. It was awful.
Let me have my space. Let me do my time. You got in my space, and we're fighting. I didn't want nobody around me because I hated everybody and everyone and everything in my life.
As it turned out, it was a cross-section of our community. Some had violent backgrounds, others were caught in addictions. Most were more ordinary, the sort of people who were neighbors, co-workers, a father, a mother, a brother, or sister. The one thing they all had in common was that something in their lives didn't feel right, and the traditional Western paths weren't working to make them feel better. The ceremony was held at night in a teepee in the tradition of the Native American church. As each person entered, they whispered the words, "I do this for all my relations." Then cedar smoke was fanned across them with eagle feathers as a spiritual cleansing. The medicine man, or road man as he called himself, was sitting on the ground opposite the doorway by a small altar consisting of blankets, a wood chest, ceramic bowls, jewelry, and totem figures. An Indian pipe rested on his lap. The other participants sat down on blankets and a circle formed around a blazing fire. My son and I got seated, then I looked around at the others. Some were wearing brightly beaded medicine bags, others had feathers, and a few held drums or rattles. When the door came down, an uneasiness gripped me, as if I was about to drift off into space and leave my world far behind.
My first two steps in there, I thought, what am I doing here?
My first impression was like, oh, this is interesting. I thought this was going to be a Native American ceremony, and most of the people were white. So I was like, I was a bit skeptical.
I was skeptical, very skeptical about this, you know, spiritual ceremony, like la 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 la. Why can't these people, was my attitude, why can't these people get this themselves?
The ceremony opened with people expressing intentions for what they wanted in their lives. We were warned not to express those things in a negative way, such as not being addicted, or depressed, or fearful, or alone, but instead focusing on what we did desire, such as freedom, intimate relationship, happiness, or faith. To be asked what one really wants from life, it was curious how that question made some of us stumble.
My first ceremony, I was asked, what do you want? It actually, the medicine man ended up making my intention for me, because what I said was so convoluted, and it was just this mumbo jumbo of, I don't want to use drugs, I had never really thought about it. And finally, after about 5 minutes of my stumbling around, he stopped me and said, I'll give you a really clear, simple intention. I want to know that I am beautiful.
I don't want to think like a drug addict and an alcoholic anymore. I don't want those thoughts. Because it'll destroy me if I keep trying to go back to that path of life. And I ain't ready to die today.
So, what your intentions ought to be is on, I only want to put things that are really good for me into my body.
The roadman lit his pipe. I was told that the stem of the pipe represented Creator God, the bowl Mother Earth, and the tobacco all things on the earth. The smoke was a physical manifestation of prayer, a coming together of all things. He allowed the smoke to waft over a bowl containing a green paste and across several mugs filled with a tea. It was a blessing on what they called the medicine. When a person stated a clear and positive intention for what they wanted, they were passed the medicine which they scooped from the bowl and ate, followed by drinking the tea. Several winced as they ate and drank it.
Did it make the medicine taste any better? No.
It's so clear. It's an unmistakable taste. You'll never, ever forget it, like ever. You'll never, ever forget it.
Finally, the bowl was passed to me, and I saw that the roadman was looking my way. The medicine man says, "Why are you here?" And I say, I brought my son, and he's got this problem. And the medicine man says, "You know, what can you do about it?" I said, "Nothing, I'm helpless." He says, "That's right." He said, "The only thing you can do is get well yourself and show him how it's done." I had come with the expectation of watching my son participate. In an instant, the tables were turned, and now he was there as a spectator to watch his father walk a path that was strange and mysterious. I stared down at the bowl and scooped out a small lump of the paste, then slipped it into my mouth. My whole body jerked. This was by far the worst tasting thing I'd ever eaten. As I fought to get this medicine down, the roadman started asking the others simple questions about their lives, and I was about to see people as I rarely see them.
The effect that sexual abuse had in my life was that I was really disconnected from my feelings.
I can't think of a worse hell than to battle drugs and alcohol and addiction.
When Saigon fell, I had a week in which I couldn't talk to anybody, but I jammed it down and I thought I was over it.
I grew up with a lot of dishonesty. Nobody was ever honest about what was really going on. You know, are you mad? No, I'm not mad. The reason I'm hitting you is because you did something wrong.
I saw the abuse that was going on between my father, you know what I mean, like my mom.
And really, in my heart, I wanted to not use, but I didn't know how. I couldn't possibly perceive within my own mind how a person doesn't use that thought and felt like I did.
My mom was everything to me, and she was an incredible woman, and, you know, she was all that. And also, it was devastating when she died.
And I remember he had us all lined up on the lawn. And my mom says she no longer wanted us.
I felt invisible. I felt like everything that was real that I was feeling wasn't real. And so somehow I had to make it go away. And we were all living this illusion.
As I listened to their stories, I was struck by two things. One was how much we hold inside all the time. Had any of these people been asked outside the teepee how they were doing, they probably would have answered fine. I also saw in their struggle with anger and addictions those same seeds of disconnection from the beauty of our world that had taken root in my life. How could anyone hope to be free enough to see that beauty with so much poison coursing through their blood? As the first hours of the ceremony passed, it was becoming clear that the impact of the medicine in my body was quite different from what I had expected. Despite my prejudice against drugs, somewhere deep inside I was hoping for an experience that would take me far away and out of my life. That wasn't happening. Instead, I felt like I was crash landing right in the middle of it. As the others told their stories, something disturbing began to take place in me. I was about to discover how the medicine reveals where a person is living out of harmony with the world and with themselves.
I felt so powerfully nauseated.
Every time I heard the word shame or guilt spoken, I began to get really sick.
I had a lot of nausea, in all of them, but I only threw up in one. And that was really a hard one.
She said something like, I need to get rid of the lies. I need to get rid of the lies and know the truth about, you know, my beauty or something like that. And at the same time, I'm throwing up. And she was saying that. It was very cool to see it, not to do it.
And this Marine, ex-Marine from Vietnam, then starts to talk. James starts talking with him, and he begins to talk about his life and the difficulties he's having at that time, raising a family, supporting a family, just how hard that is on him. And I start to feel sick. And the more he talks, the sicker I get. It is connected to what he's doing. And I'm thinking, what is this? I mean, what is going on here? And at some point, I would have paid this guy to shut up. And it was agonizing. And finally, he began to talk about Christmas. And when he hit Christmas, it was like somebody kicked me in the gut. And I just lurched forward and started throwing up. And I was in a lot of pain. I had discovered one of the aspects of the medicine meeting. All the dishonesty that I had embraced in my life just to function in a competitive, judgmental world suddenly began to make me sick. My past acts of unkindness and pettiness floated to the surface like waterlogged corpses, and all at once it was painful to be me. I entered the teepee feeling fairly sure of my ground. There were problems in my life, but I had created a sort of balance that, even if tenuous at times, got me through. That balance was now being shaken. Visually, there was only a slight oddness, but my mind was slowing down. Emotionally, things were more clouded. As the others told their stories, I went spiraling down into my own problems. From a distance, I saw my family and how I sometimes treated them badly. I also saw my tendency to see life as a string of duties and jobs I had no choice but to do. This medicine was now taking me outside my life to look back in, and what I saw was unsettling.
Man, it's amazing what a simple question can show you, like, you know? Simple, simple question, like, how are you? And I can just open you up, like, what, how did,
And they'd say, how are you feeling? I'm like, I guess I'm sad. You know? So why are you sad? I guess it's because I see these incredible parents here. I see these incredible mothers and fathers. And for me, it was my mother and father that died when I was 10 that I miss so much.
There was a woman that I was sitting across the fire from, and I just remember through the whole morning, she was working all morning, and I was so frustrated. I was just like, why can't this woman just answer the questions? Why can't she just tell the truth? Because it was like watching her do this dance with words, and it was just like, it's yes or it's no, and she'd be like, okay, but and just not being able to focus in and tell the truth. And so that was a huge lesson for me. And I didn't realize it at the time that it was just showing me what I do.
There were seemingly endless hours of feeling sick, all spurred on by the others' stories. Then sometime in the night, we were asked to pray silently while the roadman left the teepee and blew a whistle to call for help from the four directions. I was told I would need the support of Earth spirits, that they would strengthen me to get me through the ceremony. At that moment, I would have taken help from anyone. I was sitting in the West, which also represents those times of life when one withdraws to rethink the path one has walked. And I found myself pondering that evening when I sat with the gun. I had come in my 50 years to view the world as a hostile or at best indifferent place. In this teepee, I was glimpsing myself as the hostile and indifferent one. That there might be spirits coming to help me through the ordeal made the universe seem friendlier. This ceremony was not going the way I had expected. There were no wild hallucinations, no frenzied dancing or screaming. It had, in fact, been very introspective. But my biggest misconception was what I had believed to be at the heart of the ceremony. I thought, of course, that it was peyote. Peyote is not the focus of the medicine meeting. It's a sacrament that helps bring a person to the fire, and the fire is a representation of God. However one defines God, either as a physical being, a spirit, or a creative force, whatever one can embrace as the power which connects all things and wants something good for us, it is the center of the ceremony. Pride keeps one from going to the fire. The medicine breaks down pride. When I was deep into the sickness, someone whispered that I should focus all my attention on the fire, tell it what I wanted, and it would get me through the night. At times, it was all there was to hold to. Peyote is the path, but the fire is the destination. As the ceremony ended, it was clear that something important had happened for me. However, it was difficult to say whether anything had changed for my son. He had sat back and watched his father struggle. What that would mean to him, I didn't know. As hard as this was, I was pretty sure we would have to come back again. And when we did, it would take all my courage. I came back from my first ceremony, and it had not been anything like I had expected. And all night long, I'd been getting these clear images of things that I do and have been doing, and where I'd been dishonest, and where my anger had been leaking out on my family, and I'd been grumpy with them, and I had been distant and disconnected from them, and had kind of carried them as a burden, as though they were a burden in my life. And I'd been seeing this, and nobody had talked to me about this. It's like it had just been there. And so when I came back, I called my family together, and I wanted to apologize to everybody. And I thought this was going to be one of those really warm, wonderful moments. And so I started in, and I started talking to them about it, everything I'd seen in this ceremony. And I went around and apologized to each person individually. And for the first time, I saw the anger in their eyes. I instead of this being this kind of touchy-feely moment, I could see their anger. And it was the first time I had understood, you know, I could see in their eyes what I'd been doing. And it shocked me. And my first response was to get angry at them. Just to say, well, if you're going to be, you know, do you realize how much I've done for you? And to go into that. And but then I remembered how sick I'd gotten in the ceremony every time I had drifted towards that kind of perspective on life. So I backed off and just said, oh, well, let's work it out. Thank you.
lost self-respect, self-love, got into the drugs real hard and heavy.
I went to a second ceremony, but this time my wife came instead of my son. I'd begun to realize that the problem went beyond him to my whole family, and it had something to do with me. I wasn't sure why. I sat back and listened as people told their stories.
And then, right before my 18th birthday, I got in a fight.
There were these Vietnamese guys who had been in a North Vietnamese prison for 28 years.
The person who turned me on to heroin was my AA sponsor.
I got into a fight.
I had really allowed my heart to get hard. It
was so great.
What
was going on inside of me was so great that I couldn't
explain it to anybody. It's definitely a problem knowing how to forgive my parents.
Put myself into being their father.
I got into a fight, and basically I beat her up.
So if that's the way they want to feel, to heck with them.
At some point, I was asked about my father, and as I answered, I went sliding back into my childhood. My father was a quietly intelligent man until he was drinking, which was often. Then he was loud and foolish. There was a constant tension in our family that it was about to break up, and I lived in fear that he would embarrass me in front of my friends. He often did. As I sat there remembering these things, the rage I'd felt toward him came back. But the greater anger was probably over my sense of abandonment, because when he drank, he seemed to go far away, even when he was with me. There was a crushing sense that he chose that over me. Now I remembered that it hurt. Someone in the circle asked where all that pain and rage had gone. Did I think it still might be in me? And was there maybe a connection to that suicidal evening? I stuttered, hardly able to answer. Then they left me alone with the fire to mull the question over. As I sat there, I was glimpsing people as reservoirs of old anger and pain, silently holding it until some event caused it to spill out, and usually onto those closest to them. I've watched friends trample paths to self-destruction. I've watched their marriages disintegrate. I've watched them become trapped inside attitudes that smothered their hopes. Caught in narrow, self-protected ways of interpreting their lives, they came to view anything too close to them, even a husband or wife, as a threat. I stared at the fire and found it hard to accept that there was that much anger in me. I pushed the idea away, then my attention was drawn to a man in the circle as he told his story. Something odd was happening. His words thundered inside me.
My father is a recovering alcoholic now. Back then, when I was a young child, 12, 13 years old, drugs came into my life. I thought I found what I needed with them. I had a lot of hatred in me. The drugs killed the pain. So I chose that road. I lived that road for many, many, many years. I stole from everybody I knew.
I recognized the anger that had driven him. It was the same as mine. My heart sank. This anger had sat invisible inside me for a long time. Could I ever get past it? All through that night, that question circled through my mind. In the next days after the ceremony, I sought people out who had done this for a while and asked if they'd had any experiences that gave reason for hope that we could get beyond our past.
One of the things that happened for me in the first medicine ceremony that I did was I realized that my suffering as a war veteran was a thing that I loved and that I had to be willing to give it up. And it wasn't that much of it left. I mean, it was still there. Like, I realized every every day that I spent, you know, 395 and a quarter of them in Vietnam, I remember every day. I remember what happened on every day. And I asked to let go of it. I asked to be allowed to give it up because I saw that it kept me from being in this day. It was very easy for me to form that intention and let go. I was just stunned by how it occurred to me in exactly those kinds of words. It was in my heart and in my head at the same time. And that I had this moment in which Spirit was going to allow me to give that up to it. Like, you know, you want to let me have that? And I said, yes, please. And since then, I felt so unencumbered by that. It's not that it didn't happen or that it's not in me or that it still doesn't totally inform my experience as a man and a human being, but it's not the thing that creates who I am anymore. And it was for a really long time.
It has been far more painful than enjoyable to have any sort of intimate relationship, whether it's a friendship or an intimate relationship in a partner way, because my level of fear around something happening to them was just extraordinary. Like, I'd think about it all the time. And it, even though I knew intellectually that no loss could be as hard as being 13 and my mom dying, so with men and women, I've really kind of, my whole life, set up relationships for the most part where there wasn't gonna be that level of intimacy. So this epiphany, you know, that I had of just like, oh my God, I've been given everything. And to really get that notion of my job now is to stay really open to all the blessings in my life and not to close because of fear or because of rage or because of lack of faith. But the sense of peace I have, I have never thought it possible to have the amount of peace that I have in my life right now. And that's...
People spoke of moments in which life was seen through different eyes and how that made it possible to be in the world in a better way. For me, the medicine meetings had just been hard, digging up the past and showing me where I'd been causing trouble. I began to wonder if that would be it for me, but I kept going. Then on a frigid winter night, things took a sudden turn.
And as he spoke, something really strange happened to me and really wonderful happened. It was like a veil was drawn back from my eyes. And I saw, first of all, everybody in that teepee as being absolutely beautiful. And then it spread from there, and I saw everything else that was beautiful. I saw the world was absolutely beautiful, and the sky, and the night sky, and the teepee we were in, and everything was just absolutely beautiful. And it just went through me that everything had always been there to support me in my life. Everything. And the people around me, and the beauty of the world, and everything. And it shocked me. It absolutely shocked me. And I realized that God had always been there. He had always, this is a hard life, but God had always been there trying to support me in one way or another. And I looked at my son, who I'd seen, you know, quite honestly, as a burden to bear. And I saw how beautiful he was. And I remember the day he was born, you know, and how beautiful he was that day. And I fell back. I was literally blown over by this. And I laid there for I don't know how long. And I felt all the anger in me towards God, which had been tremendous, just leave my body. And I felt something that I had tried to feel so hard in my life, but I had never been able to feel, gratitude. My body was filled up with gratitude. And it was the sweetest feeling I think I've ever had.
Floundering in the sickness, I'd held my focus on the fire, in prayer. For weeks afterwards, an unfamiliar feeling stayed with me, happiness. However, as powerful as the experience had been, I now wanted to understand why I had stood in the mouth of the cave with the gun. Also, nothing had changed for my son, and we were still looking for an experience that would set him free. We would be coming back. However, something had to be sorted out before there could be more ceremonies at Oklevueha.
One of the reasons why that a lot of Native peoples have a reluctance to have non-Native peoples within their, within the ceremony, is because the white people have taken everything that it possibly can from Native peoples, yeah. in not only the United States, but in this Western Hemisphere.
There's people running around doing ceremony that don't have this right. The right for these things is passed on through time. All of this earth is for us to use, but this earth here is for us. These ceremonies are for us to use. We can pray for the whole world. We can pray for other races. We can pray for non-Indians. But this is the way we have. After all that's been taken away from us now, at this time, the spirituality is being bastardized in when they're doing these other ceremonies off the reservation.
Years of conquest, murder, and discrimination had planted a deep distrust of white people in the hearts of Native Americans. Now the children of their enemy were asking for help. There were some among them who believed that non-Indians should not be allowed in the peyote prayer meetings, and they were pressing to put an end to the Oklevueha ceremonies. However, I found that this belief was not held by all.
Does it matter what color they are? If they're...
No, it's all one. Yeah, just one. It don't make no difference of the... nationalities, no, it's an all one. So no one would ask me, all I can do, just eat peyote and fix it for them, give it to them. That's all I can do. The Creator takes care of everything like that. I've got a way of giving medicine like at the same time, you know. So that's it.
A native plant, a native traditional medicine. It's for the world to use. It's for anybody who is sick, who's injured, who is in great need.
But that doesn't mean you have to run out and buy a war bonnet and be an Indian. You get this help, get the prescription that he provides for you, and then go on with your own life. Be who you are.
Enough support came from Native American elders to keep Oklevueha going. However, two warnings were given. The first one, don't mix money in the medicine. And the other, don't change the ceremonies.
Hey, thanks for being here.
Those attending the medicine meetings were now encouraged to alternate them with sweat lodges. Both are intensely physical, but where the one uses nausea to reveal a person's disharmony or sickness, as the Native Americans say, the lodge shows it through anxiety and claustrophobia.
I started to get a wave of fear.
I was either going to die or I was going to stay in there and God was going to be with me.
It feels like death is just coming at you like a bullet. You try to run away from it, you can't get away from it.
And I learned about putting pride down.
I think I lost my mind a little bit.
The only thing I could do was ask for God's protection and for God to help me. That was, I felt like it was the only way I was going to live.
It was suggested that my son and I try a sweat lodge. I'd done saunas and I didn't think this would be much different. Here I felt more sure of myself. This at least seemed like familiar ground. A typical sweat lodge is constructed with willows arched over and bound together. It is covered with anything that will hold in heat. Stones are superheated in a large fire, and when they are glowing red, they are brought inside the lodge during four separate stages of the sweat. The lodge symbolizes the womb of the mother. The red-hot rocks carry the power of the fire, that is God. the great creative being or force, into the womb. That first time when the door came down, I felt utterly cut off from the world. A fear gripped me that I was about to die. I fought to get control of myself. Water was poured onto the rocks, filling the lodge with a suffocating steam. The temperature shot up, but even worse, I could barely breathe. My fear turned to panic. I needed to get out. But then in one last desperate moment, I remembered the lesson of the medicine meeting, that in times of crisis, I should focus on the fire. I got close to the earth and chanted my gratitude to God. Instantly, the panic began to evaporate like a cloud turning to a mist, then disappearing altogether. It was replaced with an expansive sense of freedom. When I left the lodge 4 hours later, I had been humbled. It had been a near-death experience, and I re-entered this world with a rekindled appreciation for it and the people in my life.
I had really allowed my heart to get hard towards those children. I had talked myself into saying, I don't care. If that's the way they want to be and live the rest of their life that way, fine. I'll go ahead and live my life, and that'll be it. But those ceremonies changed that completely. And that, especially that sweat lodge with my two sons. I came back from that knowing that my heart had been totally softened by that sweat lodge ceremony, totally.
I was watching people's pride melt in the heat of the fire. A month later, I went to a second sweat lodge, but instead of feeling good, I emerged at the end stiff and sore. Someone said this came from my reluctance to give anything up, even self-destructive attitudes. He told me that next time I was in the sweat lodge, I should call on God, then lower my guard and face my worst demons. That can soften a heart, he said. If you doubt it, watch the men in the lodge who've been to war or in prison. See how it opens them up.
I had to go back after that sweat later on that day, the next day, and for a week after, and apologize to anyone that I felt I had disrespected. In fact, had disrespected, thought of disrespecting, and apologize. You know, with the contrite heart, hey, I'm an asshole, I seek your forgiveness, I was doing you wrong, you know. And of course, they thought it was a manipulation because they knew who I was and what my crime was, etc., and that they wanted, you know, what's up, Randy, you know, what's going on? But I felt good, and I mean, for the first time in my life, I felt God hold my hand. I mean, literally, hold my hand and Mother Earth caress my feet. That was a turning point for me and for those eight men that were in the lodge.
Well, it comes around to me, and they ask me what I want, what I need. I remember I asked to know why my mama left me when I was 3.5 years old. Why she didn't love me. Why I called her all these names that wasn't fit for a dog to be called those names. And I called my mama every name in the book because I hated her that much. During that first round, as I poured all this hatred I had out, it got hot. And I'm being a man, I'm sitting up, I'm taking the heat. Because that's what I was told I needed to do. Sit up, take the heat, be a warrior, be a man. Get it out of your body. James is working with me, asking me questions. What I'm feeling, how I'm feeling. And he says, get it out, cry it. And I'm crying. I work through it. And before we get completely through all the brothers in the lodge, I'm feeling at peace. I'm feeling my mom next to me,
talking to me. Telling me, son, I love you. It's not your fault. Things happen that nobody has control of. That's all I can remember. We don't have control right now, but son, I love you. It's gonna be okay.
At one time, I would have judged some of these people harshly. Now they were gaining my respect as I watched them struggle to better their lives. In these ceremonies, however, I saw things about myself. One was that I carry a fear of life. Another was that I lie to myself about it. And one such lie was that nothing ever really hurt me. This self-deception had become so pervasive that it formed a curtain through which I viewed everything in an increasingly dark and obscure way. Whatever the reason was for nearly taking my life, it was hidden behind these lies. I threw myself into more ceremonies, hoping to find it.
The men are about to do the second sweat lodge of the day. The women did the first. It's probably the hottest sweat lodge I've ever seen. We had to carry them out. So going in right now kind of made me feel like a soldier going into battle and passing the wounded on the way in. And it's giving me pause to think. It was a very scary sweat lodge. There were a lot of hard feelings in the sweat lodge. A lot of things that the men were working out and a lot of things that I felt. For part of it, I got into a place of competition, and when you do that, you start to panic, and you start, it gets to where you can't breathe, and it takes all your focus to come out of that, to focus on the good things of life, and to get past the petty things that we do over and over again, and that's the only way you can get through these things. In the last round, I had some real issues to deal with, and the only thing that got me through that was focusing on the love I have for my children. And my family, my friends. That I can bring them love and not anger and not despair, but love. I've got that in me.
For the first time, I was feeling the walls I'd built up around myself as a child, made of rock-hard ideas of who I thought I was, and supported, in the language of psychology, by defense mechanisms. They were barriers meant to filter out experience so that pain and fear wouldn't be overwhelming. But these mechanisms can work too well. They dulled and blinded me to the truth and beauty I lived in, causing me to misread and overreact to people and events. The ceremony sent shockwaves through the walls, bringing them down, giving me the chance to replace them with faith in that presence I encountered in the fire. But I couldn't do this alone. I was surrounded by people with like purpose, and we gave each other encouragement and the strength to brave the hardest times. The most hopeful thing, however, was to watch another break through those walls and find a new way of being. Their shift stunned me with the force of a miracle.
And I just started getting really clear and having a lot of forgiveness for my family, for my uncle, for myself. Taking that medicine was like probably like the hugest act of faith and courage that I've, like, to this day. I don't know. I know how I did it. I had an image of like three of my kids, like, just sitting there saying, "Do it, Mom." And it was kind of this thing like, if you're gonna break patterns, then you've gotta do it, whatever it takes.
I was feeling different about my father. In spite of all my efforts, I had brought some of life's hardness into my children's lives. Now they carried anger toward me. Seeing my own shortcomings, I realized how hard it is to live, as the Indians would say, in a good way. My father's successes looked more impressive, considering the resistance all of us encounter to doing anything right, and a new respect for both my parents took root. I watched as individuals around the fire became more aware of themselves, which also triggered an awareness of others. And with that, at least for some, came greater compassion for people in general. Perhaps it was inspired by the sight of one another's struggles in the circle. But the most profound awareness seemed to come from moments of connection with that power lying beyond the narrow walls of their lives.
These moments come to them when their pride just crumbles. It just falls down around them, and there they are, kind of emotionally naked, you know, facing the universe, you know, and you can open yourself at that moment. You can open yourself to, you know, whatever it is you feel it is, you know, the creative spirit, the great spirit, the Tao, the, you know, God. You kind of tell the universe or God, you know, here I am, I need help. Something comes back to you. Like a little seed's planted right here. And it's a gift. And when your pride comes back up, which it will, that seed is still there and it starts to work in you. There's this thing that runs through my family, you know, depression and suicide and alcoholism. And it seems to pass down from generation to generation. And I see it going on in my family right now. And I want to stop it. I want to have one of those moments, you know, when I open myself up and I get some kind of gift that helps me break that, stop it. So I'm still looking for that.
But is this the only place you can do that kind of thing?
No, I think that kind of thing could happen
lots of places. I mean, in churches, on mountaintops, you know, synagogues, wherever anybody gets to this place that, you know, that they could lower their pride and open themselves up to, you know, what it is around them. We laughed a lot in these circles, sometimes at the stupid things we'd done in our lives. And there were peaceful moments, like after a sweat, when I felt clean outside and in. But the work of a ceremony was to break the iron grip hold of one's fearful, self-absorbed ego and open the eyes to a bigger vision. It was painful at times, but to be aware of the lies and half-truths I had lived in and to feel the growing connection with the world and the creative power behind it, this was worth the pain. However, not everyone who came had the same experience. Some came and went with a shrug. Others got angry, as though they'd bought a ticket for one ride, then got stuck on another. There were also those who started on this path and fell back to their old ways. I could see that change was fueled by their desire for it, and sometimes it just gave out. In the earlier meetings, I had come to understand something, that all of us push our experience of life back away from us. Drugs, anger, depression, alcohol, overwork, we use any number of things to shield ourselves from life's uncertainties and disappointments. And the more we do it, the more detached we become from the things of this world, even the good ones like beauty, friends, and family. In the last ceremonies, I was about to learn something new. There was a young woman in the circle, and when she spoke about her life, I heard my father talk to me.
It's a sickening, disgusting feeling to witness yourself being a slave to anything. It's really hard to be a human being and know that you have taken this precious soul, this life that's been given to you, and sold it for 5 cents, sold it for a little bag of heroin, you know, that's, you know, mixed with all kinds of garbage, that your life has come down to being worth that little.
Through her, imagined or otherwise, my father spoke honestly about his addiction in a way he'd never been able to in his life. His desperation, sadness, and self-contempt rolled off her lips, and I hung on every word. There were periods of relative calm at our house, brought on by my mother's angry urgings, but eventually my father always fell back into heavy drinking. This also became a pattern of my life, only without alcohol. There would be periods of optimism and work collapsing eventually with some bad news into a sense that all effort comes to nothing. Caught in this cycle, the young woman, my father, and I came to a similar state of mind.
There was this one night where I was sitting on my bathroom counter and I'd just been going for hours and just was like trapped, just shooting up over and over again, and put the needle in, take it out, fill it up, put it in, take it out, fill it up. There would be this thought in my head, you know, I'd be asking myself, will this be the one? You know, will this be the one? And then will this be the one? And will this be the one? And just always wondering if this was going to be the one that was going to kill me.
My father tempted fate with binges that put him in the hospital, but he ignored doctors' warnings, denying there was a problem. Then a DUI arrest brought him face to face with the seeming hopelessness his life had become. He stuck a gun in his mouth and pulled the trigger. The next day, the job of cleaning the room fell to my sister and me. My hands shook, I was dizzy, I nearly threw up. When you sit with a gun, you don't think about what's left behind. When you stand at the mouth of the cave, the world goes far, far away, and everything from your life falls off into shadow and unreality. The only thing real is what lies at the back of the cave in that vague light, and the trigger of the gun is the way to get there. Growing up, watching my father, I had adopted a skepticism about a person's chances to change for the better. I could see now that my skepticism was a defense against disappointed hopes that my father and our home would ever get better. Also, somewhere in the past, I had chosen to carry life as a burden, and life had responded by making the burden heavy. I narrowed my world down in order to carry it, but there was a price to be paid for that. Bouts of numbness and misery leading to anger, turning to destructiveness. I continued to follow the young woman's progress through the ceremonies. She gave up her addiction and the dishonesty which supported it, something my father was never able to do. I watched her learn to tell the truth and take responsibility for her actions. I watched her open spiritually to the world and whatever creative force lies behind it. As she did this, I got to witness something truly remarkable, something I had considered impossible, her world reopening.
What I got back from ceremonies was everything. I got back everything, and then like 10 truckloads more. I had nothing. I don't know, unless you've been there, if you can understand what it feels like to have nothing. But I had nothing. And I was ready to die. That was okay with me. I was not okay with staying on this earth, living the way that I was anymore. And to me, that's having nothing. When your life has no more value, that's where I was. And I have everything today. I have my life, I have my health, I have my self-respect, I have God, I have my children, I have a new baby, I have a husband, I have my sister who moved here to be close to me, I'm in school, I have friends, I have a community. I have a life. I understand what that means. I have my life. I've claimed it and it's mine and I'm doing what I want with it. My life isn't crushing me. The way that I'm living now supports my life. And that's everything. That's everything.
I could see that something deadly had passed between my father and me. Perhaps the same thing had happened with his father and his. I could also see that it was now passing on to my son. I needed to know what it was so I could stop it. I weighed my options and decided to throw myself wholeheartedly into a medicine meeting. For 2 weeks, I fasted, prayed, and meditated on my life, then went to what would prove to be the last nighttime teepee ceremony. It was also the wildest ride of my life. A number of ceremonies later, my son and I are at another one, and we take the medicine, and I instantly start feeling sick. And I can't get away from this sickness, and it gets stronger and stronger, and I know that I'm heading into something. And as I sat there in front of the fire, I saw the cave again. It opened up in front of me, and I knew this time I had to go inside. And so I stepped in. And as I went down to the cave, through the cave, I came upon my mother and father and myself as a child. And the three of them were having this talk. And my father was looking at me as a child, saying, "I'll never be anything. I'm an alcoholic. I'll never succeed in my life. And I want you to bear the hope of this family. Take that from me." And my mother looked at me as a child and said, "He'll never be what I hoped he would be. So I want you to bear that hope, all the dreams I'd had, that he'll never be. And I was feeling very sick at that moment, and then I said, as a child, yes, I'll do it. And I was glad to do it. I wanted to take that burden on myself because it was a great excuse for me not to engage in this life, to protect myself from this life. So I took it on myself, and when I did that, I became so violently ill, I can't even explain it. I went into a place of agony that was both emotional and physical and spiritual. And as I sat there, I was kneeling in front of the fire, and I was throwing up, and I was hurting everywhere. And I was reaching such a deep pit of agony there that I didn't think I could live. I didn't know that I could ever come back to this life from that place. And at that moment, I felt an arm come around my back. And I felt a hand on my forehead. And it was my son. He'd come out to the fire to support me. With his hand, he shielded my face from the fire and the heat, which was burning me. In that little gesture of love, I found the strength to come back. And in the end, it was the son who saved the father. The medicine had taken me to the heart of my unbelief, to the heart of my fear of life. Down in that hellhole with all my demons howling in my face, death asked how much I wanted to be alive. Calling on God and whatever angels or spirits walk this earth, and supported by my son and a community, I found my will to live and stood my ground. The cave dissolved, and I realized I'd been living in it ever since my childhood. The next morning, I stood outside in the warmth of the sun and breathed in air that was light and clean. I felt unburdened, and the beauty of this life and the world we live it in filled me up. I was glad to be alive. I was sure there'd be hard times again, but I'd been to the heart of my unbelief, and I knew how to get back. I made an intention to show more courage and exercise greater faith so that I might bequeath hope to my children. Several weeks later, my son broke through a 3-year wall of depression and started walking his own path again. I'm told among the Sioux, when there was no room for retreat in battle, a warrior would turn to face the enemy and whisper, "It's a good day to die."